Dobar dan. Hrvatska ne obnavlja dovoljno zgrada kako bi postigla energetske uštede dostatne za efikasnu borbu protiv klimatskih promjena. Usto kvaliteta izvedenih zgrada prilično se labavo kontrolira. Stručnjake okupljene oko Hrvatskog savjeta za zelenu gradnju, nedavno je na predavanju u Zagrebu, pokušao inspirirati jedan od najpoznatijih američkih promotora održive gradnje, Matt Grokov.
Make America great again. We don't need other people's permission.
Mr. Grokov, Croatian Green Building Council invited you to give a lecture in Zagreb. The title of your lecture was How to Achieve Decarbonization at the Building and Community Scale. Is this renovation very expensive?
It's expensive not to renovate our buildings to be decarbonized because the cost globally, first of all, is catastrophic, right? If we can't keep playing by the same rules, that's the big picture. But on the building scale itself, it's actually more cost effective to build to what we call a net zero energy, where the building is producing as much energy as it's using inside. So sometimes the equipment can be a little more expensive, so there's a capital cost in the front. But if we can get policies to allow people to purchase those equipment, that over the life of the equipment, it's actually less expensive because we're using less energy, and the energy that we're using is from renewable energy, which is less expensive over time. So the cheapest energy in the world right now is solar energy.
When you mentioned policies, could you mention some of them which are encouraging this sustainable green building?
Good policies. Well, first, I think that anybody who is building a building, whether it's a home or an office building or a hotel, if they're building buildings that have a carbon infrastructure, that use fossil fuels, the 5 years from now, the owners of those buildings will be own something that is almost worthless, because so many people will have converted to all electric buildings that are being run with renewable energy and no fossil fuels, and people will be demanding that the building itself will be worthless. So the economics will transform everything, whether or not there are big rules at the top. So people have a choice now without any rule changes, and there are investors around the world looking for opportunities to invest in projects that have all-electric renewable energy infrastructure because they know that those are future-proofed and they will be more economically valuable. But the policies, so the EU rules on near-zero carbon energy are very good. That's a tough question. The question that the politicians have to do.
Yeah. So it's obvious that decarbonization is connected with this democratization, decentralization and digitalization of the global energy sector. But in your lecture, it was new for me that you also spoke about degasification of the building sector and decentralization of water supply and food production.
Natural systems, nature doesn't work in a central way, but our energy and our food system and our water system are all based on 100-year-old engineering where everything is centralized. And as a city gets bigger, you make the infrastructure bigger. But now that infrastructure is old, it's falling apart, it's dirty, it's polluted, and it's harming the atmosphere. So if we start looking to natural systems and find ways that we can engineer things with the same patterns that nature does, then we have things that are built for this new climate era that are more resilient. We know that all of the facts are in about climate change. 30 years ago, we knew this was a problem. Today, we know all of the solutions. We have everything we need to decarbonize. So now that everyone has signed the Paris Accords, how do we do that? We have to degasify, we have to remove the carbon from all of the existing buildings. So that means that all new buildings should no longer be built with gas. If we build a new building with gas, as soon as you open the door on the first day, it now becomes an old building that we have to fix. So
it's expensive to fix it.
And it's much more expensive to fix it. So we need to, so first, we need to stop building new buildings with gas infrastructure. They need to be all electric with heat pump heaters, heat pump clothes dryers, heat pump water heaters, induction cooktops. All, everything we need is here today.
It's similar with food production because of this transport emissions and so on.
Right, so we can, not only can we harvest energy where we use it, we can also grow our food where we eat it.
This and then we are producing then organic, am I right?
And then of course, and then you produce things organically, and you can do that better when you produce locally. It's easier. There's less transportation involved. It can be less carbon intensive. And that doesn't mean big farms go away. We still need big farms. But if we can grow most of the produce that we eat near where we live, or even in our own backyards, or in the lobby of hotels, we can do that. There are brand new hotels in Singapore and in the United States where inside of the lobbies of the hotel, there are fruit trees where you can eat the fruit off of the tree inside of the building. So when we start looking for places that we can grow our own food, we reinvent the entire food economy, and we can reduce the carbon, we can reduce the chemicals, we can do organic food, and we can prevent some of the carbon pollution that's causing global warming.
Croatia is a part of the European Union, and I meet a lot of companies who are selling the materials for this energy renovation of the buildings. So my basic journalistic doubt is that we need a lot of emissions to produce all these classical materials like cement, steel, and we don't achieve such energy saving in these buildings where we are applying these materials. Is this real green building connected with other natural materials like straw, hemp, or wool?
Materials is maybe the most difficult challenge in green building. Energy. It's cheaper if you produce your own energy and use less. For water, you know, the infrastructure over time, you can do the math and you can show that it's better. And we know how to engineer those things. Materials is difficult because what is currently being produced is sometimes toxic. It's bad for the health of the people in the buildings. It's bad for the workers who make it. Or it's carbon intensive, like cement and other things. But a lot of big manufacturers around the world are beginning to change their own materials and change the marketplace.
Or to mix this natural and synthetic.
Yeah, or mix, you know, so they're engineering the materials in a better and healthier way. We're finally beginning to asking the question, what is toxic?
What is your environment?
In our environment. We're doing carbon assessments and figuring out, should I use this material or this material? Well, this one uses less carbon to make it. I'll choose that material. So we're beginning to make smarter decisions, and manufacturers are seeing that the marketplace is shifting. And the ones who are succeeding are the ones who are making better materials, what you know now called green materials.
Do you use any thermal cameras in the state when you are checking the quality of energy renovation of the buildings? Because we don't use it in Croatia.
Good builders will always use a thermal camera.
But it's more corporate responsibility. They are not obligated.
It's not obligated to do it in most places in the states. Possibly in California now they're starting to require some of those. In Canada they're starting to require a label on the building that shows how much energy it uses to do what's called a blower door test. So they depressurize the building to find all the air leaks. So they're using science to figure out how can I make this house more efficient and lose less energy. But more importantly is the retrofit market. Like how do you fix old buildings? Because there's many more old buildings than there are new ones. So the challenge is to slowly over time fix these buildings. The first thing to do in these old buildings is when something needs to be replaced, begin to decarbonize immediately. And if you can afford to decarbonize everything now, it must be done. So, you know, a stove needs to be fixed. You take that out and you put in induction. Your water heater, you put in a heat pump. So one by one. And then we can put solar panels on the roof, wind farms in the water, wind farms in the fields, and everything else can be powered with renewable energy.
Let's talk about greenwashing. A lot of companies are claiming that they are fighting against climate change, but they don't do enough. Do you have some good examples?
So across the world, no matter what country you're in, consumers are fed up with what we call greenwashing. You put up something and you give yourself a plaque and some applause, and you're a green building. People are smart, and now you have Greta Thunberg in Sweden, who stands outside to strike for climate and has inspired students around the world, demanding that these companies do that. These children, their parents, are the consumers, and they're demanding these changes. So you're starting to see very large corporations respond. You're starting to see automobile companies saying that they're going to be all electric. You're starting to see the manufacturers put solar panels on their buildings because they're discovering it's cheaper for them and the consumer will buy the product that came from a factory with solar panels. The cosmetics and not having toxic materials, the building materials, everything. Companies are becoming more and more responsible, and the companies that are not are being punished. And equally important is that the shareholders of these companies are putting pressure on them, because they're literally selling stock from companies that are being environmentally irresponsible. They're selling portfolios that have companies that use a lot of carbon. And they're rewarding companies, and they're investing in companies that are beginning a process of decarbonization.
There is some hope for us as a civilization.
This little 16-year-old girl in Sweden says, should we look for hope? And of course, we need hope. But what we need more than hope and more than optimism is action. When we see action, when we see the decarbonization really happening, when we see policies in place that reward decarbonization and punish carbon fuels, then we'll have hope.
Mr. Grokov, thank you for the interview.